Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of When I First Held You. 22 critically acclaimed writers talk about the triumphs, challenges, and transformative experience of fatherhood. Edited by Brian Gresko. Narrated by Don Hagen. Foreword, DARIN STRAUSS. You catch me at an interesting time. Yesterday I may have failed my son, actually one of my twin sons, who is now almost 6. He has a medical condition which I don't want to specify here, and the thing is, yes, I did something that my wife thinks jeopardized his health. Not jeopardized in a huge way, but any jeopardy is more than enough jeopardy. Well, here's the thing with me and fatherhood. I'm a keen learner, sure, but mostly I'm an expert fuck-up and apology offerer. And you probably are, too. Michael Chabon says something to the effect of, every day you are a father is a day you fail. Ah, hindsight, hindsight. It's not that nobody tells you this beforehand. They do. It's hard, they say, when your wife gets that first ultrasound. They is everybody. They say it will change your life. We hear those words, we think we know what they mean. We don't. We really don't. And after the unheeded words, we actually have the kid. Or, in my experience, kids. So, what happens? After the opening scenes of childbirth get acted out, after your days and your nights morph into thickets of wiping and swathing, you realize parenthood is an executive position and a mid-management job, and entry-level. Decisions, hundreds of decisions a day, then the attempts at implementation. And the plastic Optimus Prime is always hiding behind the divan, the dainty chin is always pointed right at the hard pavement, the ambulance is always revving just outside. You may see me and my kids walking into a kindergarten class, but what do I see? I see not them exactly, but countless reminders of countless mistakes, tears, yellings, cracks in the playroom wall. So, why do we do it, and why are you here, listening to this book? I think you are here to laugh about how hard other dads find things, but also to have something else, a hard-to-describe contentment described to you. Because the joys of fatherhood are real, but not often put into accurate words. There is an intensity of some emotion, not happiness, definitely not happiness, but something like contentment, only more profound than that. Sometimes I feel it in my chest when I am with my kids, a warm fullness around the heart like a water heater squirting everywhere inside the rib cage. That is not the kind of thing I've seen elucidated very well, or often, until I picked up this anthology. There are great essays here, wherein great writers do just that. Here's Ben Greenman telling us, it is rejuvenating to locate yourself near the start of things, whether a child's life or an essay. There is much left to do. There are so many chances to get it right. And André Dubus III, explaining that being a dad is knowing that something is here among us, something I cannot see but feel, something I cannot hear but sense, something I cannot smell but know. This mystery feeling comes up again and again, as with Chris Batchelder, who tells us, I don't pray, but I pray every night in the dark silence of my daughter's bedroom. That's worth feeling, men learning about the astonishments and awes of fatherhood. And anything worth feeling is worth listening to, if it's well articulated. The same night when my wife told me, wrongly, I think, that I had jeopardized my son's health, after a stomach-twisted, head-down day spent wondering if I could do this for the rest of my life, and why had I chosen to do it, my twin boy, the one I had worried about, asked me if I might come observe him and his brother do a somersault show on the bed. Watch, Daddy, the boys said, rolling into each other and into my arms. And I smiled and felt the tears come. Watch. Introduction, Brian Gresko. Before spending back-to-back days at my neighborhood playground chasing my toddler son, I was that guy, the young man who swore never to be penned in, domesticated, anchored to a wife and children. I claimed to be a free spirit. The thought of commitment and responsibility left me trembling with panic, my eyes darting to find the nearest exit. These days, when I browse my Instagram feed, rife with photos of me and my son, Felix, I'm often surprised at how I never thought I'd be here. Felix was born 5 years ago. He did not come easy and spent the last few hours of a long labor stuck in the birth canal. When the heart monitors made clear that both his and his mother's lives were becoming endangered, a vacuum device pulled the baby into the cold glare of the birthing room. A doctor cut the cord without ceremony, and instead of placing him on my wife's breast, a trio of nurses in blue scrubs buzzed about his body on an infant-sized table. I couldn't see what they were doing exactly, but when I caught a glimpse of my son's arm, it looked mottled with bruises, the skin tinged with a sick, purplish hue. "Why won't he cry?" my wife whispered. Only then did I become aware of the room's silence, the midwife and our chipper, amazing nurse, who had been a cheerleader throughout the whole ordeal, had found cleaning chores to keep their hands busy and eyes cast away from us. They were attuned, I sensed, to what was happening on that little tray. I stood next to my wife, emotionally poised between exultation and upset, on the shore of a great sea of fear, unsure whether the tide was running in or out. Seconds elongated in brittle quiet, till a doctor announced, "We have a heartbeat, and it's strong." After the attendants siphoned mucus out of my son, my wife received him. But the midwife took him after only a minute, flipping Felix over and banging his back with a cupped hand, as if he were a doll, not a baby. "Give him to the dad," someone said. I nodded, not realizing this meant me. In the moment I held his tiny body, he snorted wetly and frothed a bit at the mouth. "Is this normal?" I asked the midwife. It was not, and pediatricians whisked him away to neonatal intensive care. For a while, my wife and I sat together in the delivery room, scarfing sandwiches to fill stomachs that hadn't been fed in 20 agonizing hours. We talked about the scary, intense labor, but strangely didn't discuss the baby in any detail, not what he looked like or how he felt in our arms, where he had rested for less than a minute. I felt only an abstract anxiety for the boy, as I might for any child in distress, more a sense that I should be concerned than concern itself. Why, I wondered, was I so cold? I worried that maybe I lacked a gene, a mutation passed along by my biological dad. When I was 10 years old, my parents revealed that the man I thought of as my dad was not in fact my real dad. My real dad was out there somewhere, though who he was and why he didn't want to be a part of my life, my parents wouldn't say. It was obvious to me that the circumstances of my birth caused them great pain and distress, a discomfort they broadcast with teary eyes and pinched expressions, so I swallowed my questions. I now know that my fear of fatherhood stemmed from that silence, a fear I brandished into adulthood with pride, as if I was tough and hard-boiled, though on the inside I still felt like that confused 10-year-old boy. Even sitting in the delivery room, my unknown paternity turned what should have been declarations of love and support into question marks of self-doubt. Later, the doctors allowed me to see Felix in the NICU, recovering, they explained, from inhaling fluid on his slow way out. He looked sickly and small, laid out on a table beneath a warming light. A breathing tube obscured his mouth, monitors tattooed his pale chest. Some, in a gesture I found ironic and completely inappropriate, were adhered by cheerful rainbow-colored stickers. "Hey, kid, it's your dad," I murmured. I stroked his arm with my finger, and then he wrapped his little hand around it and locked his striking blue eyes on mine. That's when it hit me, the intense love, the desire to be the best father I could for this boy. I promised him then no secrets. One day I would tell him the story of my origin and provide him clear answers when he asked about his roots. Most importantly, I vowed to raise him with an uninhibited, open heart. A few weeks after arriving home with Felix, I talked to my biological father for the first time by phone. Beset by financial problems, he had had a tense relationship with his own emotionally distant father, wrecked two marriages by womanizing, and sired three other kids who hadn't quite believed him when he came clean to them about me a couple of years before. "My son," he had the nerve to address me, "can you forgive me?" Actually, I could, because I realized that I didn't need him, neither as a child nor now as an adult. I already had a dad, the man who had raised me as his own son. There's a photo of him just moments after my birth, his eyes big, their hazel tones brightened by his green scrubs, his face washed in emotion, my tiny form nestled in his arms. He didn't have to be my father. He chose to be. "When I first held you," he told me, "I knew. I wanted to be there to see this kid grow up." I wanted the same, but I wanted to view my son's childhood in extreme close-up with emotional X-ray vision. I felt an almost physical urge, after years of ambivalence, to get as deep in the muck of daddyhood as possible, to not just be there, but breathe in every moment, good or bad. So after about 3 months, I became my son's primary caregiver for about 8 hours a day. As with all things parenting, a financial consideration weighed on this decision as well. Felix was born a week after I graduated with a master's in fine arts and creative writing, and I had no job, while my wife wanted to go back to work. Being a stay-at-home dad made sense for both my heart and our budget. One might expect minds to be open and conventions challenged in Brooklyn, where families come in all shapes, sizes, colors, and makeups, and where I've lived for 15 years. And yet the stereotype of the male as financial provider, as the stoic, tight-lipped cowboy, or the predatory, besuited businessman loomed large. "A year off with the kid? That sounds like fun," one acquaintance said when he first heard of my situation. Another asked if I did chores around the house and then revealed that he once folded laundry for his wife, smirking at me all the while. Often strangers offered their advice on the street about my son's behavior, his clothing, even the direction I had the stroller oriented. "You know you're getting the sun in his eyes, Daddy," one well-intentioned nudge-nick told me. "His little eyes are very sensitive. You have to take care." Solicitations my wife didn't receive, since she wasn't the clueless dad. My first winter alone with a not-yet-walking baby drove me stir-crazy, especially when frigid temperatures kept me housebound. I longed for company, specifically another stay-at-home dad who might be going through a similar experience, yet I wasn't sure I wanted to meet the kind of guy who would cop to the title, even if I spotted one. Like many parents, I bristled at the term stay-at-home, because it boiled my entire identity down to parenthood. What would we talk about? Bottle feeding and diaper changing? It turned out, of course, that other dads were out there, though these lone wolves largely kept to themselves on the playground, eschewing the packs of nannies and mommies. Maybe, being men, we're of a more solitary nature of our parenting, because paradigms of engaged, active fathers are hard to find, or because men, encouraged to be strong, brave, and authoritative, find themselves shy or uncomfortable discussing the intensely emotional world of parenting, a place where our sense of control can be illusionary. Perhaps men of a certain age are wary of making friends with one another in general, or these guys shared my fear of having dad buddies who would only want to talk baby. But I knew dads were out there, in greater numbers than ever, in fact. The Census Bureau estimates that the number of men acting as primary caregivers has more than doubled in the past 10 years, and surely the amount will continue to grow in the next decade, as the assumption that men belong solely in the workplace and women at home recedes in our cultural rearview mirror. As I met other dads, both working and stay-at-home, I found that many men had struggled with inhibitions and anxiety around having kids. Only the specifics of my story were unique, not the sentiment. I learned that the majority, like me, discovered fatherhood to be both a transformative space and also one thick with dark matter. I'm not talking about in the abstract, the societal stereotypes I touched on already. I mean on the ground, in the nursery, and especially on the changing table. Seeing your children's growth up close and observing their personalities spring forth in fits and bursts, with new traits emerging almost overnight, as if all this time these little beings harbored much older, more developed selves within, is akin to a miracle. I remember the first time Felix smiled at his own reflection, the first conversation we had, in which, of course, he wanted to know when Mommy would be home, and the first time he said goodbye and walked off to class on his own, a self-proclaimed big boy. Hugging your child, smelling his or her scalp, might raise the hairs on the back of your neck and cause a pleasant lightheadedness, a buzz not unlike the one you experienced during the early, most innocent phases of a teenage love affair. Your kids will run to you in distress and cry for you at night, and you'll feel not just loved, but needed, truly important in their life. Even today, I frequently wake to find my little boy curled beside me in bed. "Can you put your arm around me, Daddy?" he'll ask, knowing the answer will never be no. This, however, is what we generally talk about when we talk about parenting, how it's wonderful or a wild ride. We don't discuss the manner in which the intense positive and negative impulses of paternity, of contemporary parenting at large, revolve around one another as electrons do protons, antithetical yet concurrent. Parenting is challenging work because of what it requires physically and mentally, but also because of these constant contradictions. Alongside the day-to-day joys, you'll find your attention span wrung out, your intellect understimulated. Kids demand so much, especially when young. Patience will be lost and breaking points reached for both parent and child. Inevitably, every man asks himself, "Am I a good father or a good enough father?" This anthology provides stories of men speaking with unflinching honesty about their experiences as fathers. Full disclosure, no secrets or candy coating. I turned to 22 of our most beloved and accomplished contemporary male writers to pen these essays, authors whose work I've reached for before when seeking both entertainment and something else, something more, nourishment, let's call it, grist for the thought, octane for the spirit, vital, primal stuff. A multitude of voices are included from men of different ages, with children at all stages of life. Apartments are made crowded by the addition of a baby, and then rooms go empty when children leave for college. Taken together, the essays create a nuanced mosaic of fatherhood, the darks and grays amid the highlights. No father's story is simple or monochromatic, but that's life, isn't it? Especially life with kids. Though one would rather not be caught in the midst of the nastiest crisis, here you'll find reassurance that help will appear. André Dubus III takes comfort from his father's wisdom and strength from his wife. In Stephen O'Connor's case, a Russian cab driver provides advice and later lends a hand. For Steve Edwards, a doctor proves willing to go to extra limits to put Steve and his wife's minds at ease. These essays illustrate how a father is never alone, whether facing an accident, illness, surgery, or, in Garth Stein's case, buckets of vomit. And while these are the sorts of things you'd like to put behind you, like the winter when Felix was two and caught every germ known to mankind, you may find yourself feeling as Ben Greenman does, recalling things that didn't exactly happen, while the things you expect to remember forever slip away. What is clear is that having a child clarifies the passage of time, the family line, and a man's sense of himself in the world. A few of the essays, most explicitly Justin Cronin's, address how fatherhood has led to a renewed faith in the divine. Carl Taro Greenfield finds genetic traits coming into clearer focus, for better and for worse, while Benjamin Percy and Anthony Doerr each consider their own mortality, less with paralyzing sadness and more with a sense of life's great movement. In other pieces, the guys get into the nitty-gritty of parenting, talking about anger and frustration, Marco Roth struggles to figure out his role as an authority figure in his daughter's life. Bruce Mahart would rather do anything than play pretend. And Chris Batchelder loves his daughters, but sometimes wishes they would shut up and allow him a moment's peace. In these, one finds the daily struggles amid the many joys of parenting, the fight to keep a sense of self, of independence, of personal space, of private imagination, a semblance of cool, while also being a responsible father. To paraphrase Alexei Zentner's eloquent essay, fatherhood is like learning to breathe underwater, painful but not without its pleasures, primary among them, laughter. Fatherhood strips a man of certain delusions about himself, some of which Dennis LeHane lists with insight and humor. Though at times your laughter may be thick-throated and bittersweet, such as when comedian and novelist Bob Smith cracks jokes in the face of his life-threatening illness, ALS, which has taken his ability to speak to his two children. Several pieces examine the great personal challenges of fatherhood, how, as DARIN STRAUSS writes in the Foreword, a man faces failure every day. Lev Grossman and Peter Ho Davies specifically discuss the impact fatherhood has had, or not had, on their writing. In one magnificent sentence, the astute Rick Moody puts his finger on the crisis of contemporary fatherhood, how dads today are asked to play a multitude of roles, some of which seem at odds. Moody's essay and several others talk of divorce and separation, and yet the child is never to blame. I challenge you to hear Matthew Spector telling his daughter how she is the one thing he will not fuck up in his life, and not find your heart swelling with promise for your own child. For all the obstacles each author faces, and parenthood certainly brings with it a good number of problems and conundrums, the type men and women have never dealt with before, the kind you just can't practice for, because if you could, you probably wouldn't choose to have a child. For all the bullshit and heartache, each essay sings of joy and love, and of a life lived fully. Spending time with your child, even a boring snowy Saturday morning in February, leaves you feeling, in Frederick Ryken's words, like nothing is happening and everything is happening. The world moves so slow and yet too fast, which Andre Osserman also acknowledges in his contribution. Let the essays here provide a moment to catch your breath, to stop and reflect and commune with the voices of guys who might not know exactly what you're going through, but probably get the gist of it. I hope that these narratives inspire you to be the best parent you're capable of being, knowing that you'll never be as good as you want to be. Forgive yourself for your failings. Don't let fear silence you or frustration cripple you. These may be understandable emotions to feel when it comes to our children, but it's totally useless to hold on to them. Instead of shying away from the fire or being consumed by it, tame it, let it reforge you. After all those years of deploring fatherhood, I can't imagine my life without Felix. My love for him comes from the gut. It's indelible, a constant. Even the most difficult of tantrums thrown over the smallest of stakes, bedtime, say, or finishing his peas, end in a warm hug. Being a parent is confusing, complex, and challenging, but as André Dubus III puts it, it's as if my deepest, truest life could only begin once I became a father. Amen to that, sir. On Love and Incompetence, Dennis LeHane. Since I had children, trips to the supermarket have become ubiquitous. Twice in one day is not out of the norm, the second time usually to pick up something I forgot to grab the first time. Three times isn't unheard of, usually to pick up something I forgot the second time. After a recent trip, I pulled a packet of yogurt bites out of the bag, and my wife said, are those the organic kind? My wife and I don't want hormones pumped into our daughter's bloodstreams from birth, so embodying every yuppie cliche about well-meaning, left-leaning urbanites, we usually shop at Whole Paycheck or Reader Joe's. But I'm also from a working-class background, where I'm fully aware of how much fun I would have made of people like me back in the day, so I'm not above giving my wife a hard time for her organic obsession, which far outweighs mine. I promise these paper towels come from organically cut down trees, I'll say, and this aluminum foil was harvested in a field in Vermont. So I'm fairly certain my response to her question about the yogurt bites fell along the lines of, "They're yogurt bites. She'll survive a chemical or two this one time." My wife forgot about the exchange, and I forgot about it, and we moved on to the next phase of our day. My youngest daughter, Kira, was just short of one. A few weeks later, at a family gathering in a restaurant, my wife and I laid out some food for Kira, and she ate it, as she usually does, two-fisted, shoveling in pieces of cut-up pear and cut-up grilled cheese and cut-up grapes so fast we've been forced to question whether the cutting up can keep up with the speed with which she ingests. We also dug those yogurt bites out of her diaper bag and laid a few out for her. A moment later, when I saw a couple of the yogurt bites heading toward her mouth, I registered a clear and quick thought. Those seem big, even for her. And my wife said she registered a similar thought. The non-organic ones don't melt as well. The built-in safety measure of yogurt bites is that they dissolve almost instantaneously once they hit the tongue. Well, the organic ones do, anyway. So when my daughter, 364 days old at this point, began to choke, my wife and I knew exactly what had caused it. And we knew to remove her from her high chair and bend her forward and pat her back in an upward motion with the heel of a hand. Still, she kept choking, and her eyes rolled back in her head. Then she vomited. And I thought, okay, that's good. Vomiting means she's exhaling. And I told my wife this, which worked to calm her down. But my daughter continued to choke. The color changed in her face, her eyes rolled even farther back to the whites, and my wife and I exchanged a blink-and-you'd-miss-it look of dire and intimate helplessness. We kept patting our child's back, we kept her pitched forward, we kept doing everything we'd been taught in baby CPR class, including tamping the impulse to reach down her throat. And just as we were reaching what felt like a point of critical mass, after which would come the lurch into full-fledged panic, my daughter vomited again, and wailed with fear and outrage, and took in copious amounts of oxygen through a suddenly cleared windpipe, and then continued to rage against the indignity of her first choking experience. I say first because my older daughter, when she was around the same age, choked twice within 1 month. Both times the culprit was a grape, which is why her younger sister gets grapes so sliced up they're practically puree. Talk to older parents or grandparents and they say, "Kids choke, you gotta watch 'em." It's the shit happens of the parenting world. Kids choke. The look my wife and I exchanged during our youngest child's choking episode was one we've exchanged a few times since becoming parents. It's a look so loaded with the worst truths that within it, I can feel at risk the foundations of everything we are as both a couple and individuals. And that truth is, we don't control anything. Nada, niente, nothing. If fate or the gods, or God or Lady Bad Luck decides to shine unfavorably on you and all you love, there's very little you can do about it. As a man who reached his 40s, a resolutely independent, happily childless, responsibility-free being, the experience of becoming a father first at 43 and then at 46 has shorn me of any number of delusions. Some of these delusions were minor. Of course I can sleep late when I feel like it. But others were the bricks and mortar of my self-image. Watching my daughter choke and being, if not helpless, certainly limited in my available responses, should that fucking yogurt bite, and that's how I'll describe it for the rest of my life, not have dislodged due to our incessant patting on her back, I was stripped of delusion number one. One, we have nothing to fear but fear itself. I'm a big FDR fan, and I've often used this line to buck myself up when attempting something out of my comfort zone. Whenever I've taken risks in my career, in fact, risks that have left many people staring at me in a kind of apprehension and or befuddled respect. And maybe I grew a little smug, because it's true that creative failure has never frightened me. And if you're not afraid of the things that most people are afraid of, creative failure, heights, snakes, and spiders, It's possible to believe you're not afraid of most things. Since my children were born, I fear everything. At its worst, the fear jolts me awake in the gray just before dawn, heart-thumping away. At its best, it lurks, as politely as something can lurk, behind most of my thoughts. I don't see electrical cords anymore. I see electrocution. I don't see dogs walking on the street. I see beasts that could turn feral without warning and launch at my oldest daughter's head, which is often at exactly the same height as their teeth. Cars drive way too fast on all my local streets, and the drivers of those that don't drive way too fast make up for it by texting with their heads down, foot on the gas. In crowds, I see potential predators. In empty spaces, I wait for an unknown mass of something heavy or sharp to drop from the sky. I don't voice these thoughts to anyone, of course, but that doesn't mean they're not there. I understand the completely contradictory impulse to bring a newborn home and then go out and buy a gun. I understand the impulse to seek safety in the most boring place one can find, severing all ties with a stimulating culture, with multi-ethnic interaction, with the give and take of a large metro area that I've always believed builds character. Screw character, the voice in my head says. Just ensure their safety, even if you have to lock them in a tower. On a recent trip, my older daughter, Gianna, accompanied me out onto the fifth floor balcony of our hotel. She's almost four, well-traveled, and knows the dangers of falling from a great height. The railings on the balcony were taller than her and didn't have gaps big enough for her to slip through. Even so, I went around and surreptitiously pulled hard on the wrought iron at every conceivable juncture to make sure it was soldered so tightly to the building that the ratio of give was zero. My daughter and I talked about how she was never to go out on the balcony without Mommy or Daddy. At night, I engaged the upper lock on the door leading to the balcony, a lock so high my wife had to stand on her tiptoes to reach it. The next day, with three adults within arm's reach, Gianna managed to push a footrest to the rail and stand on it so that she could look over the ledge at the pool below. Was she capable of falling over the railing? No, but she was capable of pulling herself over quite easily. The three adults reacted quickly and forcefully as soon as they saw her. Get down. But even so, in what I later judged to have been 15 seconds, she managed to pull a foot-tall object to the railing of a fifth-story balcony and step up on it. Just before Gianna was born, a friend of mine told me, "Say goodbye to your peace of mind." That pretty much sums it up. 2. I am cool. I write about a lot of people who are far braver than I am. They're usually cooler, too, if for no other reason than they have me spending hours to think up their instantaneous retorts for them. But I also spent a good portion of my own 20s and 30s cultivating a fairly cool persona. It wasn't all that hard. It mostly involved flashing a soft, wryly amused smile and wearing a lot of dark clothes. It's fairly easy to pull off, actually, unless you're lugging car seats, a stroller, and several bottles of formula through an airport security checkpoint, covered in a sheen of flop sweat before you even reach the gate. My single guy speed through a TSA security checkpoint was somewhere near the George Clooney up-in-the-air time of a minute 30 from shoes off to belt back on. But when my daughter drops my hand to take off her shoes too, she doesn't have to, she wants to, and our stroller jams up every piece of luggage on the belt because even though it meets TSA requirements, not every security belt canopy is built to the same height and width, and the woman behind me lets out a sigh louder than a winter gale, even though she clearly saw me, my brood, and all my equipment in the line before she stepped into it, and I set off the alarm because I left my watch on, and single guy never left his watch on, not in 20 years, and the woman sighs again, I realize I'm only as cool as my pressures allow me to be, or my clothes allow me to be. And the other daughter, the one-year-old, just drooled a combination of milk and quite possibly battery acid all over the shoulder of my once cool leather jacket. At least I think it's battery acid, because normally milk doesn't burn a permanent mark in leather. 3. I will live forever. Our own death surprises us, Hence, the whole cycle of denial that greets imminent news of it. In the back of our minds, we think, yeah, it's going to happen, someday, I get that. But we don't. Not most days anyway, and rarely when we're single. The moment I held my firstborn in my hands, I knew I was going to die. There was no sentimentality attached to it, no woe is me. Just this. Holy shit, I have to provide. Not just for now, but for the rest of her time on planet Earth. The veil dropped. I was going to die. On any number of levels, big deal. But it would be a huge deal if I died without my wife and children having been taken care of. Gianna likes to go into the room where I keep most of my books and play library. She pulls a book off the shelf, brings it to me so I can check it out with an imaginary stamp on the back, and then goes to hide the book, God knows where, the dishwasher once, before returning for another one. I recently pointed out Daddy's books to her. She said, "You wrote all those?" I said, "Yep." The peacock's feathers rising until she pointed to the novels which happened to fall alphabetically after mine, those of one of my favorite writers, Elmore Leonard. Gianna said, "How come you don't have as many books as him?" Now, I was, of course, proud that my almost 4-year-old grasps the written word enough to recognize Elmore Leonard's name repeated on 30 hardcover spines, but I was also dismayed because that's a frightening question if you're thinking in terms of consistently providing for your family. I don't write a book a year. I wish I knew how, believe me, now more than ever. And since my daughters entered the world, I've tried to pick up the pace only to fail miserably, because my books simply wither when placed under the duress of hastily chosen words and half-baked structure. And that's all my paltry imagination is capable of if I have only 6 months or so in which to work. But, as noted, I won't live forever, and an extra book every 4 years, say, could make all the difference to my family's future. If I continue to work in sound mind and body for the next 20 years, I'm sure the future will be rosy, yes, but I'm more concerned with the cataclysmic event, the plane that falls out of the sky, the car that skids on the ice, the inoperable and terminal something bad. 4. I am competent. Over the years, I've managed to convince a surprising number of people that I'm a competent human being. I've done this by playing exclusively to my strengths. You'll never see me publicly attempt anything that I'm not good at, from volleyball to martini drinking to tai chi. I won't even attempt something I might not be good at. So imagine my surprise when I discovered just how utterly incompetent I was as a husband and father. I was in the parking lot of a Target waiting for my wife when my 2-month-old firstborn woke from a nap and immediately set to wailing. The binky wouldn't work, neither music nor my touch would chill her out. We were in Florida at the time, in August, where the temperature and the humidity both hovered around 98, so opening the windows was not an option. And this chick has lungs. Banshees travel from far-off lands just to study the movements of her diaphragm. All glass trembles in her wake. Those kind of lungs. And the only thing that could bring her back from DEFCON 4 in these circumstances was on my wife's person, was actually part of my wife's person, and my wife was in Target. And I'm thinking, remember when I used to be cool? Remember when I used to be competent? Remember when some people actually envied me? Because not only was my daughter not stopping, she had apparently just been warming up. She found a new pitch and celebrated the discovery by reaching for higher decibels. I reached back and gave the binky one more try, and she stiff-armed it like she was posing for the Heisman, and screamed. I turned in my seat, looked out the windshield with eyes widened, I'm sure, by helplessness, and there I saw my wife stepping out the front door of the megastore. The answer to every prayer that had ever passed my lips. And I snatched competency back from the ether. I clenched it, because one of the few things I'm good at, and it's a small list, is driving. I did it for 10 years, even had a Class 2 truck driver's license before I was old enough to legally drink. I've driven stretch limos, delivery vans, and those shuttle buses you take from airports to the local hotels. When I was a parking valet, driving upward of 200 vehicles on a given night, I could make cars perform magic tricks, slide them into spaces you couldn't slip a razor blade without ever touching the brake or readjusting my original path. So I took competency in hand with my child screaming in the back of my car, and I drove forward toward my wife. What I'd forgotten was that I was angled into a parking space with my wheels pressed against one of those yellow parking barriers, you know the ones, short and long in the shape of a Fort Knox gold bar. Drove right over the first one and hit one on the other side as well. So that was two parking lot barriers I was perched on. As my wife watched in horror, and I swear to this day some amusement, I dragged the underside of our car in a series of spasmodic lurches over two loaves of cement with my baby screaming from the back. "I don't even know what to say to that," my wife said when she got in the back of the car and took the baby to her breast. "I've never seen you act so...
stressed?
Dorky." She followed the description up with 1,000 qualifiers, including those meant to paint it as a compliment. "You've normally got it so together that it's nice to see you flail around like normal people." But I assure you, my wife's seen me flail around too many times for this compliment to be genuine. In the ensuing months, I would prove that my incompetence was no flash in the pan. I overheated bottles, left full diapers sitting atop the changing table, pinched my child's thighs with the seatbelt of her car seat, twice, opened the door to the refrigerator when she was just starting to walk and heard a suspicious thump from the other side of the door that made me ask, "Where's Gianna?" a half second before her stunned cry answered the question. I've lost my temper and lost my cool, and I believe I officially lost my dignity when I begged a 9-month-old to just please, for the love of God, just please, please, go to fucking sleep. I have never been worse at anything in my life, and yet you'd find it hard to believe from this essay, which concentrates on the internal basket case me, not the external I got it me, but I'm the hands-off parent. The one who lets the girls go hog wild at the playground in the belief that it's through falling that you learn to pick yourself up. My wife is far more protective, far closer to the helicopter parent variety, though she keeps it admirably in check most days. One of the ways we differ in our parenting lies in our approach to the metropolises in which we often find ourselves. I grew up in the city, my wife in a small town. My love of the urban is manifest and clear to anyone who reads a page of my work or spends 10 minutes in my company. When I was growing up, it was common to hook up with your friends, gang-hop the turnstiles, and joyride the subway for the day. Sometimes we just spent days running through multi-tiered parking garages downtown because all parking garages of a certain height had great views from the roof and security guards could only catch so many of you. I find myself unable to help trying to engage my girls on this level. I want to show them that kicking a can is almost as fun as kicking a soccer ball, or that there's as much wonder to be found staring at a city skyline as at a Hawaiian sunset. It was with this in mind that during a trip to New York City a couple of years ago, I took my eldest daughter into Times Square. She was a few months shy of 2, and she loved the lights and the noise and the way the neon reflected off the buildings in a sherbet wash. The traffic was clogged around Times Square that night, far worse than normal, and outside of what appeared to be a convoy of mint-conditioned, souped-up muscle cars stuck bumper to bumper on 48th Street, I couldn't guess what was causing the holdup. Lots of police around, maybe more so than usual, but it was hard to tell. In any case, all those lights, all those buildings, all that vibrancy, my daughter ate it up. When I told my wife where we'd been, she said, "Is that safe? Times Square?" To which I replied, "It's not 1977 out there, honey. It's practically Disney World." This version of Disney World, as we discovered the next morning, had been infiltrated by a Kramer jihadist in a smoking Nissan Pathfinder, it was primed to blow up a good section of the block it was parked on, which was half a block over from the point where my daughter and I had decided to return to the hotel. So it would seem that strolling your daughter around Times Square the night a terrorist tried to blow it up would be the height of parental incompetence, But I would argue that the terrorist is no different than the great piece of unknown that could fall from the sky if I were walking across a meadow with her. It's the anything could happen at any time chunk of fate that, yes, wakes me up at night and is related to the fear. But not the competence, or lack thereof. The next time my daughter was in Times Square, she said, "This looks like the place you took me with the girl and boy on the building." It took me a minute to get it. The girl and the boy were the images of Tina Fey and Steve Carell projecting out from one of those three-story tall, half-block-long neon ads for Date Night, a movie they were starring in at the time. My daughter, for clarity, said, "The girl had messy hair." In the ad, yes, she did, though Ms. Fay has always seemed otherwise perfectly coiffed in public. My daughter said, "Daddy, I like this place," which made me feel vaguely competent, which lasted right up until I put her sneakers on the wrong feet and didn't notice until 10 minutes later when she told me. 5. Single life is better. It's always struck me as ridiculous how we in this society exalt parenthood to the point that the childless among us are deemed somehow inferior to those of us who choose to have progeny. Many people who choose not to have children are heroes when compared to people who clearly shouldn't bring children into this world but do just that and make a mess of things. They raise offspring who channel their compendium of issues into violence or white-collar robber barony or low-class welfare fraud. They help make the world an often terrible place, these maladjusted, poorly or corruptly raised miracles of life. So those who choose not to propagate that cycle because they fear it's just not something they'd be good at, or because, as one childless friend of mine proudly put it, they don't like being interrupted, I applaud you. Having said that, and having been a member of that cohort for most of my adult life, the most surprising aspect of parenting has been how much my pre-parenting life looks like a cloud in the rear view. I can't imagine what I ever did there, or why I got up in the morning, as opposed to getting up at 3 a.m. to change a diaper, or why I didn't do this sooner. Well, actually, as to the latter, I know why. I hadn't met my wife yet. Recently, on yet another plane, we asked our older daughter to entertain the younger one. My older daughter is endlessly exuberant. Sometimes this is quite frankly a pain in the ass, because high energy without an off switch can wear a middle-aged parent out. But her exuberance is also undeniably charming, if only because it's so pure. She's not a show-off or attention-starved. She simply likes to engage or be engaged. Do so, and what flows out of her is often inspired and definitely interesting most days. So she sat beside her little sister, who's so serene we often wonder where she came from. And Gianna opened up the in-flight magazine, which is mostly filled with glossy ads, and commenced to tell a story to Kira. The doctor in one ad was going home to meet his wife, the woman in a Whirlpool ad, and they were going to drive their car, Mercedes ad, to pick up his mommy, Alzheimer's ad, at her house, where she was looking out the window at her flowers. And then they were going to visit Princess Gianna, who would tell them some things about pink. Then she looked down at her little sister, closed the magazine, and said, "I love you, Kira. You're my favorite baby I ever had." Now, a few minutes later, during takeoff, Kira was screaming because of the pressure on her ears, and Gianna was asking why she couldn't watch something on the iPad, and both of them were acting pretty hungry and irritable, and we still had a lovely 6.5 hours of air travel to go.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.